question is, what happens to that? And I think the view is, you know, that could be retained locally, that could be better spent locally around promotion, advice, support, engagement. You know, as Brennan's point about supporting young people, getting the advice right, so that rather than, you know, going into two or three things before they find the thing that they want, that they're in the right thing first time round. I think there's also something about making sure that the curriculum is available and the right training courses are available for all businesses. They're in the process of being changed at the moment, and I don't think it's, I think there's a number of gaps there that we could usefully help out with, and use businesses locally and use funding locally to support our local businesses in that.
Carla.
There's a number of issues there. I think the first thing to note is that the advent of instruction in the degree apprenticeships is providing a different opportunity for young people, in particular, to consider, you know, gaining qualification, getting their degree, getting a professional qualification, without necessarily incurring significant fee debt. So I think that's one point. I think some of the professions, some of those professional occupations have adapted to that more quickly than others. You know, I think the engineers, certainly mechanical engineers, civil engineers are starting to introduce some degree apprenticeship routes. The accountancies are, I think, law, you mentioned there's some capacity within training contracts. Clearly that's an issue for employers, because they are jobs. I think there's also something we've started to see, certainly paralegals come through as a high level, as an advanced level apprenticeship, and all the new people that presented to the committee last year, we saw a photo of before, as one of the apprentice ambassadors, was one of the first in the country to get that advanced level apprenticeship. So I think there are, I think that the degree apprenticeship and professional qualification for law, I think, is perhaps taking a little more time. I think that's perhaps to do with opinions within the professional body. But I think the fact that we're starting to see nursing degree apprenticeships, engineering, accountancy, I think we're starting to see the tide turn. And I think that a number, the perception of apprenticeships is changing as well. And amongst the different group of young people and parents who can see the benefits of getting their qualification whilst, you know, of working and learning at the same time, and not incurring that significant debt.
Yeah, I think because St. Helens Chamber are very kind of active in that regard, sometimes when we're trying to engage with the Chamber and kind of co-sponsor events, we've not always been successful. But it is one of our priorities, and we have made inroads. And also, there's, from a DWP point of view, there's a new operations manager that works across St. Helens and Halton, and he's really keen to engage with the apprenticeship club. So we will see more activity going forward.
Well,
people at the start. I think there's a couple of things there. The change in funding now requires, the change in funding to introduce it now requires small employers to make a 10% contribution towards training costs. So that is, you previously didn't receive the training for free. So I think that's why we saw a rush together those starts through in April. So I think that is one issue. And I think nationally there are some concerns. People talk sort of about significant fall off in SME start, apprenticeship starts in SMEs, which we need to dig into the data when that becomes available to see what it is locally. Within the large levy paying employers, there's a number of those employers that wouldn't have been creating apprenticeships previously, who are now, as the paper going out, are looking at how they do that. Latest projections from government would suggest that 80% of those employers will create apprenticeships, but there will be an element of unspent levy. I think it's a matter of record in the other two football clubs on this side of the water who are spending hundreds of thousands of pounds on apprenticeship levy. And I think that there's also that there are some issues about how that might be spent. So there will be funding available potentially to be used, whether that's taken back into the national pot or whether that's retained locally. I think we'd like to see it retained locally to support some of the activities we've set out. In terms of the uptake issue, I think there is a 16 to 18. I think there's a number of issues there. I think there's something about getting young people prepared for work. I think that's a Brennan's point from earlier on. I think there's something about employers looking to employ older workers, and they've tended to move, they're moving away from 16 to 18 towards 19-year-olds and more. And I think there's something about getting the right readiness in young people, which I think is an issue as well. So I think it's not a simple issue. I think it's a complex issue there. But I think as well, there's a lot of those 16 to 18-year-olds might have been accessing jobs in SMEs, which given they're now to pay for their training is may not be coming forward. So I think it's a multifaceted issue that I think we'll, as we get some of the data over the next 6 to 9 months, we'll need to keep an eye on. And through the growth hub, through the lab, through the apprenticeship hub, through the skills for growth service, I think we want to try and get a sense from employers as to what's actually happening on the ground so that we can take some of that anecdotal information alongside some of the data.
I think it was always going to be recognised that businesses were going to train their own staff first when this came in, given that over the years when times were bad, the first thing that was to do was the training budgets. So this is an opportunity to actually get the existing employees to a level that they need to be at. I'm still a bit concerned about why the schools are not actually jumping on board with this. And this is an opportunity not just for yourselves, but for local elected members who sit on governing bodies of high schools to actually be pushing this from another way. I don't know how you feel how that comes across to you. Should we be doing more as elected members on governing bodies?
Like I said, school engagement is a real priority for us over the next few months. One way into schools is through the governing bodies and anything that anybody can do to support that. That is something we've thought about in the past, whether to target governing bodies and getting that route. Key for us, obviously, are kind of the older, the secondary schools rather than your primary schools. But it's trying to go in there and give that kind of impartial information. But often what we find is that it's who you're contacting within a school, and it's when we don't know necessarily who the best person is to contact, that information that we might send through could just fall on deaf ears. So clearly, you know, it's we need to come at it from a number of angles, not just through the whole.
Yeah, can I just add to that, that absolutely, if you have been targeting governors, then obviously every local authority has a central hub where you can get information out to chairs and governors of all the secondary schools. I mean, I've done some work in this in my professional area, and schools do tend to want to push it onto university because that looks good for the head teacher. That doesn't mean that the chairs and governors and the governing bodies won't have a more general interest in this agenda. So if that hasn't been done, then absolutely, because if you just ring in the head and they don't want to kind of, you know, worry about this, they just want to push it onto uni, then they'll just forget to invite you.
I mean, that would be great, you know, that is something that, you know, we do want to do. I mean, we have, I mean, what we have seen is like a surge in the number of secondary schools that have contacted us directly, you know, so it's not, they're not waiting for us to contact them, which is really positive. And, you know, we are going into a lot of career fairs in schools and doing mock interviews and, you know, taking our stand, whatever. So we've definitely seen an increase. And we can report some stats. I've got all the stats of which schools we've gone into. And we've been into schools across the city region, so there isn't one particular, you know, local authority that isn't sort of inviting us in. It's been quite you know, evenly spread.
Okay, in that case, can I invite the elected members to write to the portfolio holders and push this as much as they can, and also probably the chief officer for the Children and People's Department of Education, which is whatever you call them these days. Who's next? Sorry. Yeah.
I think the academies have been more open to inviting us in.
Any other questions? In that case, there are three recommendations to be considered. The recommendation 2.1 on page 7. To note progress being made against the panel's recommendations, consider the options for reporting on recommendations to the committee, and to endorse the plans for further development of the intensive dashboard. We have the recommendations. We've got the options on two. I think it's just a standard report for us. If members are happy with that. Okay. Or please, if you have anything that you need to tell us, don't wait for us to call you call us. Thank you very much. Our next item 7, which is the work plan scrutiny review from 2017. So, are you going to take this?
Thank you, Chair.
Oh, sorry.
the report you've got just formalises the workshop we had in September when members put forward their views for the work plan for this year and the potential task and finish groups that you wanted us to set up for you. So basically, section 4, just to recap, just flags up the topics that you would want to have included in formal overview scrutiny committee meetings moving forward. And today we had the update from the Metro Mayor, and we also had an update on the growth plan from Mark earlier, and these were examples of topics that you wanted to have sort of going on through the cycle of the municipal year. And I think Mark touched on an annual review being ready in January linked to the growth plan, so it's a potential topic that could come back to members if that was something of particular interest maybe in our next meeting. And similarly, the Metro Mayor talked about some of the actions and what would forward in what we call the 1,000-day plan moving forward. So again, there are topics that are ongoing that could come back to these meetings in the future. In terms of the task and finish groups, members considered a number of topics for task and finish groups where there was to be an in-depth review, and three items were selected, and these are set out in the paper. And the first one being the spatial development strategy programme, which all members of the committee want to participate in. and the paper in 5.1 sets out the proposed dates for the task and finish groups, and there's just one suggested change to one of the dates on there, if members are okay with that. The session on editing session on the 15th of November would need to be changed to the 22nd of November. And Julie can get the details of this out to everybody after the meeting, but I just want to flag up the members now. Into the new year, members asked for the other two topics, air quality and welfare reforms and universal credit, to be looked at concurrently. So again, what we asked for last time, we will follow this up with you now, is for members to express a preference in terms of which or both of those task and finish groups you'd like to be involved in, and we will get the dates in the diary, and we will nominate some officers to start doing some preparatory work on that for you. So basically, as I say, just to formalise the arrangements, and happy to take any questions.